What's happening, riders? What's going on? And I'm so sorry for the delay in my Q&A session, as I was really lagging back in my fitness program due to a lot of work, but just got back for gym and now we'll take a quick shower and then start the Q&A session. So all pumped, feel good, gonna eat good food and start the Q&A session. Well, I took a shower and I feel fresh and I think we should get going now. So I'm wearing my thinking hat and yep, my thinking hat is on. So let's go. Okay, so happy rider section number one. This week we have Bhavik Gandhi. All right, and actually Bhavik Gandhi and me are exchanging a lot of emails on my Gmail account, as you guys can see, where he's asked me a lot of questions about Thunderbird 350 and the color and everything. So finally he has booked the Asphalt Blue. So well, Bhavik Gandhi, congratulations, you have received your bike yesterday because I received your email yesterday. Then welcome to the Bullet family. It is Arkayan Mishra. Alright, congratulations Arkayan, and he has bought a GT and he just got that yesterday. I mean, this was posted on the day I did my video. So that's like 2 days gone by now. And yeah, and he's having some problems. So finding neutral is an issue. Tried to kickstart it but failed. Please post a video on kickstarting a Royal Enfield. GT kickstart system is different than Classic. Trust me, it is quite different. Okay, and I have, if you see my video, I have mentioned how to kick. So try that, it'll work. And getting it on neutral is very easy. In fact, GT gear system is again not like Classic. It never gets hard. It's like you're using any city bike, it's like that. It's so soft. It's just that we have that mentality that's bullet, so hit it hard. But in GT, you have to be just very gentle. You just do this and it's gone on neutral. So try that out, Arkayan. Otherwise, there might be some issue. Get checked. We have Keur Dio, who got his Classic 500 Squadron Blue on 2nd September and has already clocked about 350 kilometers. That's nice. Any tips? Well, Keur, I did not understand your question. Any tips means, are you talking about maintaining it or something? It's not clear, so please send me a question again and I'll answer you in my comments below. Okay, Ayush Purohit is asking me that where do I get the bar end mirrors for the upcoming GT, because the showroom is asking $9,000, alright, for those mirrors, and the please locate a store for a reasonable price. Okay, Ayush, I'll be very very honest with you. I was getting the rear end mirrors for the same price and I was really annoyed, but I know it's an outsourced company. So if you have some contacts in Delhi, there's a store in Delhi which provides Royal Enfield parts. I'd got the same mirrors in 3500 a pair and original. So check that out. Okay, so Praddy Yumna PS has asked me a question about maintaining a CL350. Well, Praddy, I hope I can call you Praddy. Praddy, just to let you know that I will be actually making a video for maintaining a 350 or a 500 Classic. So stay tuned for that video and that'll be very helpful. Okay, there's a question from Sanket Rajbhog saying, can you make a video comparing each and every aspect like speed to maintenance of a Duke 390 and a Classic 500? Well, Sanket Rajbhog, both are very different breeds. Both come from completely different countries, and Duke 390 is a crazy bike. I've ridden it. It's got a lot of power. It's fun to ride. I can ride that like a street hawk. So it's a cool bike. But comparing a Duke 390, which is like a naked bike, it's a quick swift bike with a monoshock, and you know, plenty of things. So I don't think so that you can compare a Duke 390 to a Royal Enfield 500. 500 is more of the Classic is more of a cruiser style, chilled out. So there is a lot of difference between these two bikes, you know, and comparing that will be not fair enough. If you want me to review both these bikes, which I'm about to do in future, fair enough, I'll do it. But comparing these bikes, it's actually a complete different genre. So what happens is, when I'll do these two reviews, automatically the KTM guys will understand what I'm talking about, KTM, and the Enfield guys will understand what I'm talking about, the Enfield guys. So if you lean more towards the Royal Enfield, you will buy the Classic 500. If you lean more towards the 390, then you can buy the 390. So in my last 350 versus 500, you know, which one to buy video, Krishna Mohan is still actually confused that which one he should purchase.
either the 350 or standard 500. Well, Krishnamohan, I have actually reviewed the 500. You can check my video out. Why don't you actually send me an email with confusion in bullet points, and I will really try to solve this problem for you. All right, so there's one person called Kickass Nigga. I can't use the N word, bro. But anyways, that's your name. You can see that, guys. That's his. Kickass N. I'll use the word N. What is your opinion on Himalayan? Well, I am actually awaiting to review that bike. I am really doing a very detailed research because, quite honestly, I'm desperate for my second motorcycle. I just hope something comes better. Like, Himalayan not having tubeless tires is a no-no for me. It's a tourer, you know. So there are a lot of things in Himalayan which I am not yet confident about. However, I'm waiting to get hold of one. So next week I'm meeting one of my friend. If he's purchased one, then I'll be reviewing that, and I'll actually check that bike out and give you a very honest opinion about it. Yo, my man Daniel Jack, alright, he wrote that, hey man, it was a great video. Now I'm so much proud of owning a 500 Classic. People used to say it's not worth paying for some amount of power. I hope they will understand after watching this video. That was a differences between 350 and 500. Daniel, that's a great shout out. I was just trying to clear people's mind and the type of riders, you know. As you saw my video, there are six type of riders. So if you fit in one, you can purchase that bike and you'll have no regrets. So Daniel, that was a good one, bro. Yeah, so the next question is from Sumit Rocks, and he says the things that I've mentioned in my previous video of 350 and 500, is it the same for Thunderbird 350 and 500? And I'm willing to buy one. He's willing to buy one. Well, Sumit, yes, it is very similar kind of ideology, because both Thunderbirds again have the same chassis, the same look and everything. Only the engine capacity and the fuel injection and other things are different. So yes, it's nearly the same. Well, next question is from Aryan Rajpurohit, and he says, is Classic 500 better or Continental GT for regular rides and long tours? All right, Aryan, I want to tell you something very frankly. All right, my Continental GT does not leak oil. That's the best part about my motorcycle in Royal Enfield, because both my Classics, what I had in past, leaked oil. Even if I repaired it, they leaked oil. If you go at the garage, below the garage, there was always oil stains. But when I park my Continental GT, I don't find any oil stains. So I'm very proud of that. I am loving the power of this bike. When you throttle it, it's a different feel, you know. So, Aryan, if I'm too frustrated not to get any other bike, I swear, I think I'll buy another Continental GT and customize it like a tourer. Alright? So if that happens, that'll be my crazy build-off video for you guys. Okay? Yeah, but answering your question that which one's better at this stage, well, I can go on GT as far as possible. I've gone till Goa as well, so, and came back. So I think I have no issues with it, but a lot of people think that it's a little ducked ride. So on that way, if you want to just sit very comfortably straight and take the spring seat system, which will act like a shock up to you, then a 500 on a very long ride Classic would do justice. But if you given me a choice between the engine of a 500 and a Continental GT, I'll surely buy a Continental GT for the engine and the power and the feel, what I enjoy. Hi Sachin Tyagi, how are you doing? He has two questions in my comment below. The first one says, does driving at a higher RPM damages the engine? Mainly piston, as I have heard that driving at higher RPM rub up the piston against cylinder hardly and degrade piston size. Is it true? Okay, so let me answer the first question very frankly to you. Driving at a higher RPM does damage your engine, because you are pushing your engine to another level. For example, if my RPM is at 3000, alright, if the needle is at 3 and I am at the third gear and I'm at 80, I should shift if I'm finding a long way ahead, empty road, and I'm gonna go on a fourth gear. Why will I drag a bike on third unless I need some acceleration, you know? So yes, it does damage the engine, and that's why the RPM meter is made for you. And I'll tell you very honestly, I'm an old school guy. In past, in my bikes, I never had a RPM meter, you know. we went with judgment when we knew the engine is really getting exerted, you know, where the engine is getting pushed to the limit, we would change the gear. The ideology of changing gears, you should learn it with your judgment skills rather than the RPM. Yes, my answer is do not do that, definitely. Unless if you're riding a ghat, you will find this situation at higher altitudes, alright? So if you're riding a ghat, which is quite a slope, maybe, I'm not talking about 45 degree slope, but quite a decent ghat, then you will have to be in a low gear and accelerate more. And that's why they say that engines get spoiled more of people who use their bikes a lot on the ghats, you know, especially with the pistons. So yes, please be careful with that. And I hope I answered your first question right. Your second question says that that you had a long ride and after that you're planning to change your handlebar from stock one to RD350. Damn. Okay, I'll tell you why I'm smiling, okay? Is it okay for the length of clutch wire, brake oil pipe and other wires to fit a little bit of height of a RD350 handlebar as height in comparison of stock one? I think you are riding a... Sachin, you've not mentioned which bike you're riding by, but I'm assuming it's classic, yeah? If it's classic, and why did I smile is because I had put a RD350 handlebar when I had purchased my first classic in 2010. The RD350 handlebars are lighter than the Royal Enfield ones. Keep that in mind. The Royal Enfield handlebars are heavy. They're heavy with weight distribution, you know, so that it can control the vibrations. The RD350 handlebar will have a lot of vibrations because it's not that kind of a quality, you know. So you can do one thing. You can buy the RD350 handlebar and put a strip of metal on top and get it welded. So at least it'll keep the pipes intact and not vibrate a lot. Okay, so you can do that. Okay, next question is from Mayuresh Kumar. He says that is there any difference between top speed of both 350 and 500 classic? And your video is very helpful. Thank you. When you have two different bikes and both have a different cubic capacity, the speedometers do not make a difference. The power, the torque, the throttle, the pickup, you know, all those things matter, which makes the engine and the ride smoother. So for example, if you ever ridden a RX100, it has crazy pickup at the first gear. Royal Enfield won't have a first gear pickup like a RX100, you know, but on a long run, Royal Enfield will be more smoother to ride than the RX100 because it's just 100cc. And I hope I answered your question. Well, Arumul Krishnan has said that his brother is planning to buy a 350 Classic. Do I have any news related to new upgrades of new versions in 350? Well, I checked. I keep a check on these things a lot. So Arumul, good question. But I don't feel there is any change in the engine. There might be few colors which might come. I just saw that day a nice green. I don't know if it's like a retro green. It's a lightish green. It looks pretty sweet. It's pretty nice. It's like a candy color. So I think they are more focusing on appearances and everything because the bike is doing well. I mean, so, you know, I think I don't see any news on that, any changes in 350. Okay, very good question from Saurabh Sabnis. All right. He says that can you suggest me between TB500 and Classic 500? Also suggest that can he purchase a second-hand bike? Or should he buy a new one from a maintenance point of view? Well, Saurabh, when you've never ridden a motorcycle and you feel that it's high time that you should get a motorcycle, and but you just want to, you know, go for a little ride, and you're not sure that you'll keep the bike also, you're not more of a motorcycle guy, but you just want to do it, then I suggest you buy a second hand. But what will happen is you have to be very careful when you buy a second hand. You know, there are a lot of bikes which have a lot of problems. There are a lot of accidental bikes which you need to be careful of. A lot of Royal Enfield secondhand which I see on websites where my friends have bought, their T's are out and, you know, certain things. So I can make out that they've fallen down a couple of times, you know, and they've just changed the handlebar and sold the bikes. But it's okay. It's not a deal breaker. So if you're looking for just riding here and there and just want to have a little fun and then sell the bike again, I think you should buy a second-hand one. But if you want to maintain a bike, you know, you want to keep a bike and you want to maintain it like how I keep my bikes in same way, then I think you should buy a new one. All right, the next question is from Rahul Sinha. He says, I'm planning to buy a RE Classic 500 Squadron Blue. All right, he's really concerned about the mileage. He heard it gives 12 kilometers per liter. I disagree, Rahul. I think there are plenty of subscribers on my channel, and even they know that we all ride. I mean, we've been riding bullets since decade. All right, more than a decade, I've been riding bullets. 12 kilometers of wrong information. All right, and then he says, what's the actual mileage of a classic 500cc? All right, the actual mileage, what I feel of a classic, is from 30 to 35. All right, I don't think so. It can give more than that. People have tried certain ways to get it, but it does not, because the fuel injection keeps an exact flow of the fuel. That's the role of the fuel injection, that gives an exact amount of petrol for the combustion. I think you got this information wrong, and please correct your facts. All right, take care. All right, Abhinandan Kadam has written that nice vlog. Thank you for liking my vlogs. And he says he's still waiting for the review of the RE TB350. I heard that Thunderbird have less vibrations, no leakages than standard and classic. Is that true? Please reply soon. Well, Abhinandan, you got to know what my next vlog is. Yes, the Thunderbird 500 is gone for service. He's my very, very good buddy. In fact, that's the bike which rode with me to Goa. So I'm going to review that in my upcoming videos. And it's a Thunderbird 500. Unfortunately, it's not 350, it's 500. One of my subscribers has purchased a 350. I'm in touch with him. So once I get that, I'll also review that for you. All right, so stay tuned for that. Definitely I'll do that. And about the vibrations, my dear friend, no, there's no such thing that Thunderbird has less vibration and Classic has more vibration. It's just the way the Thunderbird is designed. It's a different fork assembly, and due to which you feel that. And the sitting position and the handlebars are such that the vibration gets controlled, and that's why you feel that way. But there's not much of a difference in the vibrations. And you asked me about leakages. I don't know. I had personal experience with my Classic of a lot of leakages, due to which I sold it. Both my Classics, I didn't have one, I had two, by the way. And but certain bikes which are coming now in this batch, I have met. In fact, the Blue Lagoon which I reviewed, the first thing I checked is below the engine. Put the hand and just check if there is any oil. There was luckily no oil. So I think the new batch is improved, and we have to just take care of it. Make sure the oil seal is original. All right, Anmol Ghai is mentioned that, again, awesome video. Thanks a lot, Anmol. He finally has decided which rider he is. And I'm so happy that the rider theory worked. Finally, he has chosen 350cc. Only thing is, he's confused between black, Lagoon Blue, or Ash. He likes all these three colors. Yes, Royal Enfield is coming out with real good colors, and they are doing it so well that it can really confuse people. In my personal choice out of these three, I like the I won't buy the black. I had the black. Both my bikes are blacks, so I would be confused between Lagoon Blue and Ash. Okay, Ash also looks pretty cool, but I prefer the 500 tan than the Ash. That's more retro. So I would go for Blue Lagoon for sure. In fact, I call the Blue Lagoon the bike for the Navy people. Yeah. Okay, next question is from Nishant twice. Says, hi Raj Bhaiya, how are you? My question is a bit personal. It's better to remain single in life to be a professional rider? Question mark. So sweet, Nishant. It's a little personal, but I don't answer much of personal questions, but I'll just do that for you. There's nothing like that, bro. If you're talking about life, I don't know if you're talking about life partner or peers or friends or family, but if I'm assuming it's about your life partner or girlfriend or wife or whatever. Look, man, we all find for the right person in our lives. You know, if you get a girlfriend, if she doesn't like bikes, show her your bike. You know, if she starts developing, a lot of girls have started liking bikes, they're riding. I'm so proud of these women who are doing that, you know. So I think you should not feel that way, that you should be a single to be a professional rider. Not at all. It's just that women are a little careful, and they are girls, right? So nothing like that. You can still date, have fun, live your life. It's nothing like that. Okay, so don't ever feel that you need to be single just to be a professional rider. In fact, once you get famous, you'll get a lot of girls, bro. Remember that. Okay, so Saurabh Sabnis also asked that can you suggest me TB 500 or Classic 500? Well, both are different categories. One is a highway cruiser and one is a basic cruiser. If you're looking for a lot of highway rides and you feel like the sitting of a chopper style sitting is much comfortable than a upright straight sitting, then you should go for TB 500 just for the sitting part. Otherwise, both the bikes are amazing, but it's completely on the ride form. Both bikes are designed basically for the ride form and the look. TB is more of a modern look and CL 500 is more of a classic look. So if you are more on the modern side, then you can buy that. If you like the retro feel and a little classic feel, post World War II kind of a bike, then go for Classic 500. So Pradeep asked me about chestnut color, silver or blue lagoon in a classic 350. I have actually replied to him that I am a chestnut color fan. And if you guys have not noticed, the chestnut color is a two-tone color. The head is black, the rest of the bike is chestnut color, and the seats are beige. So it's something very different, very conventional, and this is the reason I suggested him that I really like that. The rest is his preference. Alright, Dipesh Thapa, you've asked me a question that he has recently bought a torque launcher exhaust for his GT. Kick-ass, man. That's like... And yeah, he's written great sound because I've heard that. It is a great sound. And can notice some increment in performance a little bit. Bro, any question is that, do you notice any engine or fuel consumption drop issues? I have told him there will be a drop. Remember, when you add any performance exhaust, the drop is not only because of the assembly. You know, the whole unit. The drop is also because we want to hear that sound, so we throttle a lot. You know, whenever we get a free range, a good free highway, we just go vroom, you know. So the more you throttle, the more you accelerate, it will pump up a lot of fuel and it will consume a lot of fuel, and there'll be a drop in the average. His next question is, will it affect his engine also, bro? Again, it also depends. If you keep revving it just to hear the sound, it'll definitely screw up the engine. So don't keep revving it just to hear it. Even the duk 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 bass is enough for us, right? That's what we want. We want the exhaust to make us feel that there's a good bass and there's a good thump. That's it, man. You don't need to rev the engine all the time. I think that's really useless. So don't do that. If you're doing that, that can damage your engine for sure. So Akshay MD is asking me, he used to start his CL350 using kicker during mornings, but at some time kicker makes some hard noises like tak tak. It's pretty much loud. Is it a problem? That sound extremely weird. Yes, that's pretty common. Actually, what's happened is there are few kicks when you're doing are not completed. It's not a full kick, but you feel you've done a full kick, due to which there is some vacuum created and then hits back and makes that noise. So you need to be careful. Go smooth and it'll start. So just be careful. All right. Okay, Milan Nalwali has a very detailed question. He said he has watched all my videos and he's my subscriber. Thanks for subscribing, it means a lot. And he says he's gonna be 19. Okay, cool, young buddy. He loves the Continental GT and test rode couple of times, and he loves the way it looks, and even he connects with the masterpiece. But he has a confusion between GT, KTM, RC 200, and AS 390 is a bit too much power for me. I love the way RC looks and handles. Both are for different purpose, I realize that, but I'm still confident between them. GT doesn't have all the modern day features that KTM RC offers. I don't know which one to buy, and maybe you can help. Alright, Milind, well, Continental GT is a retro looking bike, alright? It is the Royal Enfield breed, so it's iron horse, you know. And KTM is more on the performance based. If you're talking about the RC, it's like a sport bike, right? It's like a small mini sport bike with just 200cc, but a lot of power. And even the 390 RC. So if you are inclined towards, because you're 19, you're young, and I'm sure you have a lot of KTM friends with you, and you must be having very less bullet friends, but if you're young and you feel that the sports bike is much better option and makes you enjoy life and the ride, I think you should get a RC 390, not a Continental GT. This is just my suggestion. Think twice. Why don't you take a longer ride on the GT and a longer ride on the RC, and whichever is comfortable and fits your bill, go for it. So Stefan Ashby says he enjoys my video in Cambridge, UK. Keep up the good work. Thank you so much, Stefan. I'm happy that someone in UK is watching my video, so that sounds really, really cool. Someday we shall ride. So Agniva Das is asking me that I had mentioned in my previous review that Himalayan has released a new batch and where all the issues have been addressed by RE. May I know when? Thank you. I called up the RE showroom and when I had called them, they said the new batch is improved. You know, it is not coming with all those issues which was addressed, you know, all over Facebook, all over Google and all these things. So the new batch is already in, that's what I've heard. So I think when I get a hand of Himalayan, I'll be doing a test ride and check it out how it is. Yeah. All right. So the next long question is from Aniket Nayak. All right. It's a really long question, as you guys can see. And I have actually already replied on his comment, but then there was something still hanging. It is basically about Himalayan. He's done a very big research and he's narrowed down to buy the Himalayan because I think he wants to start touring. And I'm not joking, I've done a test ride, if you see one of my past videos, which was not a review, it is a test ride. So when I really rode it, I found it very comfortable. You know, when it comes to touring, I actually went there to buy it that time. You know, that was my plan. I was like, let's do it. You know, I need a tourer or any other bike. So, but anyways, I heard the same news what you've heard, and that's why even I took a step back. And yes, the new batch is there. I'll test ride that. But if Royal Enfield is claiming that they have repaired all those things, then I think it's pretty good to go if you're sure about it. But I found it under power, which I mentioned in my video too, because I ride a 535cc. And Continental is not only for the look what I have bought for. I've actually bought for the performance. And on that note, I found this bike a little underpowered, and that's why I cancelled my plan. Alright. So KL02Gamer mentioned that, thank you for your support. I think I finally found a person who knows everything about Royal Enfield. Well, actually, I don't know that much. I mean, I try my best. Just to let you know, I had total 9 bikes till now. And I had all, even the local commuting bikes, even I had a FZ, I had an Eliminator for 5 years, not Avenger, Eliminator, right? So I have quite good knowledge of most of the bikes. I'm a big Triumph fan and I like the Bonneville a lot. I'm a total bike enthusiast. So thanks for the compliment. I don't have all the knowledge if you think, all right? So Roshan Samuel has a similar question about TB350. So Roshan, I'm gonna, as I mentioned, one of my subscriber has purchased, I have even taken his name in the happy riding section of my previous Q&A. So if he allows me to review his bike, which might come next week or something, I will do that. And you've also asked me, is TB350 good in good for commuting in the city? 100%, it's such an easy bike, you know. In fact, TB became a rage for all the bikers who were thinking that Royal Enfield is very heavy and very difficult to maneuver because they were using the city commuters or you know, the 100cc bikes or 200cc bikes, and they thought, no, this is quite a heavy chunky bike. But when the TB was launched, people found it, the low ride, to be very easy and comfortable. And that's why Royal Enfield had launched that, because they had to launch a category where every size, shape, human could be comfortable with riding a Royal Enfield brand, you know. And that's why they launched this TB. So for city commuting, yes, TB350 is very easy to maneuver and move around. It's fun. Alright, so Bijendra O says that he would like to see some tips on videos on off-road exhaust from RE4GT, and then he will have, I will have a subscription. All right, Bijendra, I hope you subscribe, not for such conditions, but just subscribe. And yeah, honestly, I have not heard of an off-road exhaust officially announced by Royal Enfield, except for the Megaphone second category, which is a little upswept. So it's pretty cool, but I have not heard, unless you know something about off-road. And also one question, Bijendra, I mean, do you know Continental GT is a very short travel fork system? So it's not actually for off-roading. So just be a little careful, all right? Just to let you know. Okay, so Alex Joseph says that he is 5'5" and only 60 kilos. Is Thunderbird 350 suitable for me? Alex, just to let you know, how much do you think I weigh? I am 65 kilos, my friend. And yeah, and my height is 5'8 and a half. You are 5'5". Thunderbird is a low ride. Yes, I think you can ride this and enjoy. And I have a very, very amazing comment from a person called Mahesh Rao, who says, you might soon reach 10,000 subscribers effortlessly. Way to go, Raj. thank you so much, but I think 10,000 is quite far, but anyways I'll give all my best to get there, and thank you for all your support.